No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Thank you.
You are perfect in all of your ways.
in all of your ways. Perfect in all of your ways. True one. You are perfect in all of your ways. Perfect in all of your ways. Perfect in all of your ways, true one. You're a good, good father. It's who you are, who you are, who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am, who I am, who I am. Good, good father. Like a sweet perfume, I pour my life all over you. Let my worship rise like a sweet perfume. Mary, did you know that your baby boy born gave up on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? That little child you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know your baby boy will give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know your baby boy would calm the storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kissed your little baby, you kissed the face of God. Mary, did you know? Mary, did you know? The blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again. The lame will leap, the dumb will speak, the praises of the Mary, did you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know your baby boy would one day rule the nation? Did you know your baby boy is heaven's perfect land? That sleeping child you're holding is the great I am.
He's my uncle. Let me add, not by mere words, he's my uncle. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to learn under your feet. understand, to apply, and to use all what we are going to learn to your glory and to the blessings of our home, our society, and our country, even our church. For we have prayed in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 I was told to talk on God's ultimate purpose for marriage. God's ultimate purpose for marriage. When I got this, I realized that there is nothing, even we as human beings, we do without a purpose. If you are doing anything and there is no reason for doing it, that thing is not worth doing. If any person that is doing something without a reason is a mad person. And then what it means is that for God to have instituted marriage, that God had a purpose. And then we qualify this to be ultimate purpose. What it means is that God's ending estimation, God's ending projection to instituting marriage. Of course, all of us know that marriage is instituted by God. And if it is instituted by God, what is his purpose? So in the next 18 minutes that I have remaining, because I've already used two, they told me 20, we will try to talk on what is God's ultimate purpose. But before I go on, let's define the tense in the topic. There are active words there. We have marriage, we have purpose, and ultimate. What is marriage? Marriage is defined as a legally and socially sanctioned union between a man and a woman. You know, these days, when I gave my CV, I said, married to a woman, married with one wife, who is a woman. So it has to be identified and very well made very plain that my wife is a woman. Praise the Lord. So, you know, people are married to those who are not women these days. So these days, I'm married to my wife, who is a woman. So, and first of all, that is what God meant. So it is a union between a woman and a man. Not a man and a man. Nor a woman and a woman. So, but marriage is legally sanctioned. Is socially sanctioned. Sanction means that it is something that is agreed, something that is attainable, something that people are taking as a norm, both in the legal field and in the social world. Now, if you see somebody moving, a grown-up person, man, moving with a woman on the street, the first thing that will enter your head is, are they married? If you now find out that there are no married, there will be a kind of despise to their working together. I don't know whether you understand what I'm saying. So, if you now ask whether they are married and they say yes, you don't have problem again. Because in your sense and in the way we portray it, they have established something that's supposed to be. So it's a sanctioning. So it is something that is agreed. is something that in the social world, every person has taken it to be like that. Praise the Lord, though. It's a union regulated by laws, rules, customs, beliefs, attitudes, and preserve the rights and duties of the partners. Even in the most remote place, there are laws, there are rights. For you to have believed that this person is married to this person, although they may vary from community to community, but each community has laws and regulations and rights established that respect the institution of marriage. It's also accord the parties status for their children, and also be said to be coming together of a man and a man to fulfill God's purpose in either or both of the partners. I'm going somewhere now. Now, a man and a woman coming together. This is another definition I'm trying to define here. For the purpose of fulfilling what God has created either both of them or either of them. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So, God has created each and every one of us before now, before we got married, for something. The enhancement of that purpose is what marriage brings out. I mean, for that to say, it's a highly spiritual and emotional union between two opposite sets. Between two opposite sets. And I'm making these things and emphatic about them. Because God's own will in marriage in the first place is not man and a man. And or woman and a woman. So it's a spiritual union. Highly spiritual and emotional. Let me just say three nights ago, I saw a woman that came to the hospital about 1:30 a.m. So when I came, they say emergency. So I came, the woman came to the consulting room. I said, "Madam, what was the problem?" The children were now explaining that after eating, she went to bed. As she was about going to bed, she started shaking. In fact, she was still vibrating in front of me. So when I got to ask some questions, I now discovered that the husband died some time ago. And it is from then she started having those experiences. And then when I knew that was where the problem was coming from, of course, the diagnosis is not that she has BP. It's not that she has any other thing. It's purely anxiety. And for a woman that had been with a man for a number of years and have just lost the man, you think it will be easy? So it is an emotional and spiritual union. Very deep. So it's not just a mere people living together, but they have joined their emotions and the spirituality together. So that if anything happens, there's a problem. But well, let me not. I also try to define it like this: a voluntary lifetime decision made to be responsible to oneself and God towards the opposite sex under the leadership of the Holy Spirit. This one is my own now. A voluntary lifetime decision made to be responsible to oneself and God towards the opposite sex under the leadership of the Holy Spirit. First of all, it's voluntary. No person forced you. Now, if you look at the terms very critically, I say a decision that you made to be responsible to yourself and to God towards another. you are making a decision to be responsible. In fact, what I talk about marriage is that it's taking a responsibility on behalf of another person. And I added, under the leadership of the Holy Spirit. Voluntary, lifetime. So it is not something that you will do and end somewhere. And this voluntary lifetime decision is for you, is so that you can be responsible. You know, when you push back, when you push it, a responsibility to another person, you begin to find excuses. But take it as a responsibility to yourself first, and then to God on behalf of another. So, I am responsible to myself to make sure that I take care of my wife. I'm responsible to God. Not that I'm responsible, I'm seeing what my wife will do for me. What I'm seeing is what I can do for my wife under God to make something that God has brought together work. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Purpose is a reason, justification and intention for doing something. Ultimate is the final, best, and extreme outcome of something. Now, God's purpose in marriage is God's best reason or justification to unite a man and a woman. God always have a reason or plan for our life. In Jeremiah 29:11, he said he has a plan. I know the thoughts and plan that I have in mind for you, declares the Lord. They are the plans for welfare and peace, not for evil, to give you hope in your final outcome. This scripture is saying final outcome, expected end. What is the expected end of marriage? It cannot be divorce. There is no way God would have allowed you marry your wife or allowed you marry your husband for the final outcome of divorce. It's not possible. And I don't think God would have had that in mind in the first place to bring you people together so that there will be a divorce. So the final outcome, the expected end of marriage, which is the plan of God, is to, if we extrapolate this scripture, is not to bring anything evil, but to give you an expected end, to give you hope, to give you that he has planned. That is the purpose of God. This purpose can be summarized in oneness, purity, parenting, and love. Oneness is couple's union of mind, body, and spirit, which is their becoming one flesh. This can be achieved by worshiping, walking, playing, paying attention to their heads together. Other things they need to achieve oneness are: make your spouse's happiness your first priority. Make your spouse's happiness your first priority. Commit yourself completely to one another, especially in challenging times. Maintain marital intimacy. Maintain marital intimacy. Of course, all of us know what intimacy means. And all of us know what marital intimacy means. A woman came and complained that she had been living with the husband for 7 years and they never had sex. Are they husband and wife? Now that woman complained that, and then said from today, she will not be cooking for the man again. And the day she stopped cooking, trouble now. So I say, So all this one, she's one in silence. Now you are the one complaining because the woman stopped cooking. Which one is this one now? Praise the Lord. Of course, we know that whatever, the only thing that any other person cannot do for you if you are together is to have sex, if it's not your wife. But any person can do any other thing for you. It's not true. Now, 7 good years with a man without a health challenge. If there is a health challenge, of course, that's where I mentioned there. I mentioned that in very seriously, the health of each other. If there is a health challenge, we will understand that is a health challenge. Of course, there is nothing we can do about that, but it's just to help each other. No health challenge, and there is no intimacy for 7 years. Are they one? That's no marriage. And the woman want to pack out. So you see, every other thing, if you like, buy jeep, buy aeroplane, the woman want to pack out. So that's to tell you that intimacy and oneness in marriage brings about this plan of God, which is to give us what? Expected end. Praise the Lord. They should become equal partners. They should become a blessing to each other. Purity is to, another one is purity. Purity is to be free from adulterating matter. To be completely faithful to your spouse. You know, you might not be faithful to your spouse. You might be faithful to your spouse, but they are very suspicious. Well, I don't know how this thing happened. As I am like this, even if I don't tell my wife, but I usually tell, and I sleep somewhere, and I tell her that in the hotel there were 3 girls, she will not suspect me. That is not an issue. What I'm telling you is that it's not an issue. But there are people who, if they don't come back one night and sleep in a hotel, they cannot convince their wife that they did not sleep with a woman. Now, what I'm saying is me that told her, or somebody told her that I saw your husband with 3 women in one hotel. It's not an issue. Because of trust. And that, you know, trust is not something that just comes by the way. Trust is something that comes in a period of time. You don't trust somebody as you just see the person. You can only trust somebody if somebody has consistently done something for some time. It's not true. Trust does not come, it's not something that just comes in a twinkle of an eye. So there must have been day signs that it's not a big deal. Although my wife is also a doctor, maybe I heard, maybe she went to work and she cannot come. In fact, she's into an area where men are, O-N-G. So they are sleeping. In fact, what happened one day? She came one day and was telling me, "Do you know my ATM card? I don't know the pin of my ATM card, though." It's my wife that knows. People might, sometimes when I say this thing, people see, I went to renew it. They asked me, "What is the pin?" I had to call on phone. That combo, what is it? She uses, because me, I don't like that, you know, to use that thing as I'm talking to my own cell phone. So when bank was worrying, when I now went and got it, you know, that one they do in the bank, you now go and change. So she was the one that changed it and continued to use it. Now, he said one of the colleagues, they were discussing, one said, "Me, my wife see my ATM card. How would she even see it? Talk of the handle." When they were discussing about how their wife, she now brought out the husband's ATM card, and she even has her she has her own husband to hear. Now, do you think if every day I see a lot with that ATM card, will it remain in her hand? Even if that ATM card is with my wife, she must get a clearance to get money if she wants to get money. What we're talking is trust, though. What I'm talking is trust. What I'm talking is a high level of trust. In fact, this is what has eroded many homes. Trust. If you don't trust somebody and you suspect everything, there's a problem already. Even when the person is very clean and clear, there's a problem. And lack of trust is even more within us. In our own lives as believers, in our marriage, how can I trust your wife? Come on, yeah. That's what they say. Yeah. Trust your wife. Women. Then some will say men are naturally adulterous. So don't trust them. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So this is purity. To be completely faithful to your spouse, maintain, how to maintain purity. Always be on the guard. Do not think you are above sin. See, there is no person that cannot fall for sin. So you must be always on your guard. How to maintain purity. Set boundaries. You know, well, some of us, due to our own position, if you go to the office in the morning, somebody will make tea for you. That is a woman. Is it not true? Maybe a secretary will make tea for you. Somebody is sweeping your office. Somebody is carrying your bag. Somebody is doing this. I don't know if people are getting a picture of what I'm trying to picture here. But in all those things, you must do what? Set boundaries. People must know where they cannot reach. People must know. It's not you telling them you must not cross here. With your life in that office, you have already told them it is. Write it, you are even inviting trouble for yourself. But with the life you are living, they know. Come, not talk rigid as our God will kill you for you. So there is not even any need to bring it up in the first place. Set your boundaries. Have accountability. Be accountable to yourself. I know why I'm saying to yourself. Because it is easier to put yourself on the spot rather than, oh no, it's more difficult to put yourself on the spot rather than to put another person. Have accountability. Run and flee temptation. Think about the cost of not having purity. Above all, respect your partner. Another thing is parenting. The activity of bringing up a child as a parent involves promoting and supporting the physical, emotional, you know. Parenting is so difficult that it's only when you become a parent you appreciate what your parents have done. It is only at the level of your being a parent that you now realize what your mother and father, mainly mothers, it's not easy. It's not easy for mothers. So we can start sleeping when the sleep really come, but the woman will not sleep. Parenting involves a lot. Parenting is, in fact, one lady came to one of my staff came today that so she was not sick. So she was sick for the time. So when she came, I said, what happened? He said, when she was sick, the husband now told her whether she's pregnant. She said, if I get pregnant, I will kill you. Do you know why she says so? I think her last baby should be about 4 years, 5 years. And the husband wants to ask whether she's pregnant. She cannot even think of not sleeping in the night again. And then you are mentioning pregnancy near where she is. So that's to tell you the level of suffering attached to bringing up a baby again. You know, when they are in the first 1 month, they'll be sleeping in the day and waking in the night. So they'll be crying in the night. Meanwhile, you will not sleep in the day because you'll be doing other things. That night, if I want to sleep, that's when they will be awake. Sometimes we explain to mothers it's because when they were in the womb, that place is dark. So the darkness becomes the day for them. For the first 1 month, they'll be crying almost in the night. And you know how far now. Every stage has its own challenge. Every stage has its own challenge. So parenting is part of what God has instituted marriage for. The scripture, because I'm running out of time. Love is an intense feeling of deep affection to someone. Of course, we know we have four types of love: the eros, erotic and passionate love; filial, love of friends and equals; storge, love of parents, the love that parents have for their children; then agape, love of mankind, which is sacrificial. Now, 1 Peter 4:8 says, most important of all, to show deep love for each other. Most important of all is to continue to show deep love for each other. This is the final. If there is anything that is used for marriage, it's love. Love is sometimes not explainable. Love is sometimes cannot really be appreciated the way it comes. And Peter is saying to continue in deep love for each other. Now, God's own purpose is that for marriage, his ultimate purpose for marriage is that there will be a coming together of a man and a woman, and to establish his kingdom here on earth through the institution of marriage. It is now left for you to look inwards and think and postulate whether your own marriage is God's kingdom on earth. Is it an example of believers? The marriage you have. Some will say that if it is one-sided, it will not last. But in the first place, how did marriage come to be one-sided? Did it start from the day one? What were the purposes of this? How did we start? Because if we don't start well, except God does his miracle, it's unlikely to end well. So we must set our goals and in our own lives be true believers that will reflect what God's purpose is. God's purpose is well defined, but we must align ourselves and be responsible enough to key into his plan of why he has instituted marriage. Every married man, every married woman, and in this congregation we are talking more of the women, every married woman must key into this plan of God. This plan of God, this ultimate purpose of God, to give us an expected end. God bless all of us.
We'll call on our second lecturer, after which we'll take all the questions. We have time for questions, so join me as we call on Professor Oke Erundu.
Praise the Lord. Praise Master Jesus. Let us pray again. Dear Lord and our Father, we thank you for yet another opportunity and the privilege to stand in your sanctuary, to speak to ourselves. Father, we ask that you give me utterance, and that the words that will come out of my mouth will be blessings to families. This we ask through Jesus our Lord. Amen. You can see my task is going to be a bit difficult because I was asked to speak after an erudite professor has spoken. So to avoid collision, I'm going to pass through another dimension. Our mommy said something about wanting to bring out what is it in our wives that bring success, that brings favor. And so I'm going to dwell a little bit more on the text, Proverbs 18, verse 22. And I read from King James Version. It says, "Whoso findeth a wife, findeth a good thing, and obtaineth favor of the Lord." And then all of this is encapsulated in the topic, God's ultimate purpose for marriage. So if I want to piece them together, I would say that before we even begin to talk of how we will achieve this purpose, because God has already set his purpose, but there's something expected of us to do for us to achieve that ultimate purpose. And that starts with making a choice, and that is finding a wife. And that has to do with us, the men. And I try to dissect the words in this particular scripture. Whoso. And I looked at it. It's talking about anyone who willingly, anyone who is succeeding in doing the needful, anyone who is prepared, anyone who is ready to pay the sacrifice. Because marriage itself is a responsibility. And so first, the man has to decide by himself that I'm going for a journey, and this journey has to be successful, and I have to be determined on my own to do whatever is needful to make this journey a success. That is the beginning. And so when you talk about the purpose, you will now need to start thinking about what is even the man's intention for getting married. And then I'll share a story when we were, just fresh from the university. And we were just a couple of medics, doctors, young, all of us were working in a hospital. We are doing housemanship. At that time, some of my friends had, some kind of warped idea of what a wife would be. Some of them called what they call, they said is high intensity marriage. And some of them call what they said high network marriage. Some say high net worth marriage. And so we had ideas. Some people said they are not going to marry any girl who is not from a very rich family. They are not ready to suffer. They are not ready to pay anybody school fees. They want the one that has been trained and is ready for marriage, ripe. Some of my friends even said, if the girl does not have a UK passport or an American passport, they are not going to marry. So they were looking not for necessarily a wife that will fulfill the purpose of God, but there are other reasons that, form the basis for finding a wife. So when they see a Christian and the girl says, my father is a teacher, like my own father was a teacher, they'll say, no, I beg, this is not the type I need. It doesn't matter the girl's character. It doesn't matter if she's a Christian. The important thing is that, the father is so-so-so person. so that they can leverage on the girl's background to ride to somewhere, maybe to get wealthy. And so you talk about finding a discovery of something that is valuable. You know, when God created Adam and Eve, God looked at Adam. And the Bible reckoned that God said that Adam was lonely and he needed a help meet for Adam's need. And so God caused him to sleep. And while he was sleeping, God created Eve. And he woke up and looked around and saw something that was different from every other thing, every other being that he had seen. And he said, "This one is Eve. This one is the flesh of my flesh, the bone of my bone. This one is different from every other human being that I have seen." And the Bible said he took Eve as wife. And then the question goes back to the woman. Did your husband find you? Because you see, when you're looking for something that is very precious, something that is very valuable, you're ready to do anything to get it. How were you found as a wife? You know, these days, people are finding husbands on Facebook. The woman is supposed to be where she is. And the woman and the man will look for you, find you. Okay? And that's what the Bible is saying here. Whosoever findeth a wife. When you find, you now look for that good thing. And it says, when you see the one that is your own, then you know this one is good. And it's at that moment that we begin to talk about favor. And it's when the favor is available that you talk about fulfilling the purpose of God in that relationship. People are finding husbands now on Instagram. They call it hitting. Instagram hit. He hit me on Instagram. Somebody you've never met before. And even these days, they're doing virtual weddings. You've not seen the man before. You've not seen, you know. And there's this story about a young girl that saw, in fact, she was introduced to a man who lives in the United States. And for some reason, the man kept claiming that he was very busy. He didn't have this. He didn't have time to come back to Nigeria. You know, this and that, this and that. And he was taking pictures. I know me, if I sit down and take my picture and put my leg like this, you would think I'm 7 feet tall. He didn't know the man she wanted to marry was one short man. So all the pictures the man took, he carefully selected all of them, and they were sending all the pictures. And then marriage was planned. The in-laws from this place went to see the in-laws on the other side, and the girl was very excited. "I'm going to marry somebody in the United States of America." And then, after the wedding, papers were prepared, documents sent, and then she boarded the flights. And everybody bid her, well done. The people were, you know, waving at her. And some other girls were busy envying her. "You are so lucky. You have just gotten yourself a husband while we are still here in this village. Now your husband is in America, so you're going to become an American babe." And she landed in America. And then, waiting for the husband. And lo and behold, one pot-bellied short man was coming. But the girl said, "Who is this?" He said, "Don't you recognize me again? I am your husband, Tofiakwa." How did you get to this point? It is still happening now, and it's even more now. A lot of marriages are being contracted on social media, on Facebook, on Instagram. So the question is, did the man actually find the wife? What are the steps that we are taking at the point of finding? Because when you want to find, I remember when I wanted to get married, my in-law is there. When I wanted to get married, we will form group of young bachelors. We will be praying. We will do night vigils and all that, and try to ask God and pray. And then you pray some specific prayers. When I see this woman, let this be the sign that I will see. You now find, so that finally, when you meet that woman, you will know that this is the woman that God has ordained for me. You know the reason? A time will come in your marriage relationship when you will need to question your choice. I don't know if there's anybody if any man can relate to what I'm saying here. It may not necessarily be that, but something suddenly happens and you need to ask yourself a question. Am I sure that this is the right choice? That is when this process that I'm talking about now comes to bearing. When you realize how you got her, that you prayed, that you fasted, and you received direct words from God, and that you did all due diligence, you will say, Satan, get thee behind me, because this woman that you're looking at here is my wife. And when you have found the wife, what are those qualities that men are looking for? That when you see them, you know that you have found your wife and that you're going to obtain that favor. She has to be a companion. She has to be a companion. Who is a companion? Somebody that, let me in the simple word, somebody that just keeps you company, that stays around you, that you're comfortable with. You know, it's possible these days for people to live in the same house. I've heard people say, you're living in the house with your wife and you're not talking to her and she doesn't talk to you. And it happens. People live in the same roof, under the same roof. They don't talk to each other. In the morning, this person prepares and goes out. The other person goes and, and a lot of these people are Christians. They come to church, but because they are afraid of the pastor, what will the pastor say when he hears that I'm no longer living with my wife? What will the brethren say? So he or she will be managing it. They be camouflaging. When they come out in the car, they greet people and then they enter inside the car and nobody is talking. They drive and they get home. When they get home, goodbye. Everybody will enter their room. I'll touch my phone. You will be pressing your own phone. When you're tired, you sleep. Your wife has to be a companion, a friend. You know, there are also, homes where if the man is coming home or it's time for the man to come back home, everybody is jostling. People try to readjust. You try to keep things in place. The man is coming. If suddenly somebody is coming to your house now and your husband just knocks on the door, pom pom, we are at the door, are you going to change your position? That's how to know. Are you going to begin to scamper to keep things in order? If you're truly living as husband and wife, it doesn't matter whenever he comes. The way the home is the way it is. You're not going to be under burden. You're not going to be, under pressure to make sure that things are not, please the person differently. She has to be a help, a helpmeet, and a homekeeper. A helpmeet, somebody that helps you. Your homekeeper. When you come into the house, you are relaxed. There are men that as they are coming, they remove the tire, they drop it at the door. They remove the shoe, they drop it at the parlor. As they are moving the singlet, the things, and maybe the wife will be picking them and going. And then, all of that. If there are men here who do that, please repent. But what I'm trying to explain is that the home, not the house, the home is a place where a man and a woman come in. And wherever you are, when you come back to your home, you feel that you are comfortable. Financial prudence. Does she spend wisely? My brother talked about having the wife having an ATM card. No matter how much the man loves the woman, if there is no trust and if there is no accountability on the side of the woman, he will not be comfortable dropping that ATM card. In my own house too, my wife has the ATM card and she has the bank, the checkbook. But I have the alert. So that is how we keep our accountability. There is no limit to what she can spend. There is no prescription on what she should spend on. But I believe that when she spends, she will spend wisely. And then, because she also knows I'm in the picture, that if she spends and there's plenty alerts, when she comes back, she will be looking at your face. Like yesterday, we traveled. I delivered my professorial inaugural lecture yesterday. So on the way, my wife said, "Can I have your phone?" I said, "Yes, you can have my phone." And my son was in the car, and I said, "I know what you're looking for. Let me open to that page." My son said, "What do you mean? How do you know what she's looking for?" I said, "I know. What she's looking for is the balance on that account, because she's the one spending it, but she doesn't know what is left. So she wants to confirm how much is still left in it." I opened it for her. She said, "How did the thing go down like this?" I said, "You are in charge now. Are you not in charge?" Now the truth is this: because she knows what is there, she's not going to, if she finishes it, she's not going to come and hold me on the neck and say, hey, you have not given me money. You are the one spending it. I am only the accountant keeping the alert for you. Praise the Lord. But financial prudence is one way the family can grow and achieve the purpose of God. And I can tell you, my wife is a good example of financial prudence. Women are good managers. Some women. Now, for you to be able to do that as a general home manager, she's not going to be doing an impulse buying. She knows that there's money in that account. But if she sees gold, she says, "Bring." She sees a new shoe, she says, "Bring." She sees a new wrapper, she says, "Bring." All her shebis in the church, she will say, "I want to join all of them." If she's doing like that, what I will do is that I will quietly go and put a limit on the amount that she can take, so that there will be something remaining for the family. But because I know that she's able to manage it well, you leave it at that level, and life keeps going on. She must also be someone that fears the Lord. It's very important. You see, when we talk about the fear of God, one would say, "Are we not all Christians?" We are Christians. But the fear of the Lord, the Bible says, is the beginning of wisdom. That fear makes you to, on your own, be self-regulated. There are things that you will not do. It's not because your husband has annoyed you. It's not because your wife has annoyed you. But because of the fear of the Lord, there are things that you will not do. And there's something my wife says. She said, "I have forgiven you in advance." Meaning you have to make room for the other person's mistakes. You can't live in the house together and you don't offend each other. And I tell her, the best person or the nearest person who can offend you is the person that is closer to you. Unless I'm closer to my brother, he cannot say, "You just smashed my leg." Where I am, I'm not going to match anybody's leg. But when I come close to you, then I can match your leg. When that happens, how do I still sustain that favor? You need to learn to forgive in advance. And then you need to be a woman that exhibits great faith. Women are prayer warriors. Women are the ones that sustain the home. Women are the ones that keep the fire burning in the home. When we do all the running around, you are in the clinic, you finish that one, you go and talk, you do this, you do that. Somebody somewhere has to be fanning the light. If nobody does it for you, then there is a problem. That is where that favor that we are talking about comes, how often do you pray for your husband? How, you know, do you pray for everything as he's going? Rather than keep suspecting him, rather than keep quarreling, do you pray for him? Just pray for him and let him go. And God will take care of the rest. The woman must exhibit great faith. We also talked about trust and trustworthiness, which is on both sides. And then we also talk about, you know, being respectful. Being respectful. Something happened in my office one day. I had this very, you know, beautiful banker lady, and she's been having problems, you know, achieving conception. And she was one of my bankers. And that fateful day, she came to my office. I said, today that she had some time, she now complained about her problem to me. And said, normally when she comes, there are too many patients, she cannot wait. So today, is there anything? I said, no, don't worry. This one that you're around, I will just examine you. I asked her to sit down and wait for a few minutes, and I was going to examine her. While we were there, the husband called. Where are you? She said, I am at Image. I'm doing a scan. The man said, I am just by the corner. He drove in, came into the waiting hall with women, a lot of women, and watched this woman from top to bottom. He called her unprintable names. Say she's not trustworthy. How can she come to do examination, medical test? She came to the hospital without his knowledge. That's what she does. The man talked and talked and talked and talked, and I was just quiet. I was trying to calm down the situation. And then I opened the consulting room and called the man. He said, please come, and come and sit down. He sat down. I said, why are you doing this? He said, no, this woman, that's how she tries to do everything herself. She just came into this place and she's now, you know, doing medical tests. She didn't mention it to me. I said, this woman is, do you know the kind of job that she does? He said, yes. She just came into this place. And out of my own magnanimity, I decided to examine her. She's not even paying me for this service. And you just came in to embarrass her. She's only seeking for help. And she got the help. You didn't even bother to call her and ask, what, you know, how did you manage? You embarrassed her in the presence of everybody. At that moment, the man was broken. He now called it, and the lady was crying, tears all over. He now carried her. I was so pissed off. There are men like that. No respect. When you have a woman like that, you have completely, you know, she doesn't have a self-worth. She doesn't, you make her look very stupid. And I've had situations, you know, that are also close to this. A woman came and was having a miscarriage. She was bleeding. And I told her she was losing her baby. The woman jumped off from the examination couch. Boom! On the floor. I said, What's the problem? She said, I am dead. I said, you're not dead. What is the problem? My husband will kill me today. If the man hears that I've lost this pregnancy, and this is the last day I'm going to spend in that house, my husband will kill me today. Why would your husband kill you? You're bleeding. Your life is at stake. Oh my God. She said, doctor, you will not understand what I'm saying. My husband will kill me. You can't imagine what I've endured. And I said, you're bleeding very heavily. You actually need, because we cannot control this blood here, we need to go to a regular hospital where probably an emergency evacuation can be done for you. She said, I cannot go. I can't even live here. Doctor, my husband will kill me. I said, this is serious. So Since I started speaking, that woman was still wailing and crying. I said, can I have your husband's number? He said, yes. She said, yes. She gave me her husband's number, and I called. And I said, I'm calling from so-so-so place. We have a little problem on our hand. Your wife is in danger. Her life is at risk. She's bleeding profusely, and she needs help. Can I have your attention here now? The man said, I said, yes. Said, yes. I said, please, 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 come. And the man now came. We waited for him, and the man came. So instead of, what should have happened is that, oh, my wife is bleeding. Where is she? He will run quickly to rescue the wife. I first had to go into a counseling session first with the man so that the woman can be saved. We are not even talking about her life. If you are a woman here, may God bless you. I say, may God bless you. What women go through in their homes is unimaginable. So the problem was not that she's losing her pregnancy. The problem was not her life. The problem is that the man wants a baby, whether the woman is going to be alive or not. May God help us in Jesus' name. So we are talking about a respectful relationship. A lot of men respect their husbands. A lot of women respect their husbands. But I also have this particular situation that a woman came to came to my clinic with the husband. And I don't know what happened. They were just talking, to one another. And this woman took the husband and tore the husband from head to toe in the presence of everybody. People were wondering, what is going on? She said, you all on unprintable names. You're a useless man. You don't, who are you? He was just talking and talking and talking and talking. The man didn't even know how to step out of the place and leave. So, after the woman had talked and talked and left the facility, the man just stood where he was for about 20-30 minutes, trying to think about his life before anything else. Let me tell you, as a woman, the man is your crown. You are as powerful as your crown is. If your husband is a stupid man, then you must be a stupid woman. Because it's only a stupid woman that will see a stupid man and go and marry. Is it not true? Eh? Some people call names. You are a goat. If the man is a goat, then you are a she-goat, because it's only a she-goat that will permit you upon your fine body. You see he-goat. You agree, make him come pay dowry and carry you go. No, now. Praise the Lord. So, respect in the home is one of the ways that we can gather favor from the Lord. Diligence in doing meaningful things. Someone who beautifies our environment. Creativity. Ability to make the... women have a way of keeping the home. I learned my lesson very early in life, and I always tell this story. When I got married, I moved into, a two-bedroom flat, and the thing was shocking me. That time, what was in my brain was to, white color. So I painted the home white. I painted everything looking sparkling. And then, I bought these milk-colored chairs. And then the curtains and everything. Very beautiful. During our own time, they would not allow the women to come and visit you. So my wife was not coming. So she doesn't know. And me, I was happy that I'm trying. I've done everything. She's ready to come in. We got married and then entered our home. She looked at the chairs, looked at the curtains, and she told me she didn't like them. Hey! Mwanyi abiakwa. This thing I struggled to just manage and put together. Now, you're telling me that you don't like them. That you don't like the color of the chairs. That's okay. Let it be now. I used to travel all the way from here to Enugu to go and give my lectures, and I would spend maybe a couple of weeks, 1-2 weeks. So the first visit that I took, she targeted me. I don't know, she had already planned what she was going to do. As soon as I left, she bundled all those chairs and went and refolded them. She didn't ask me for the money, but I guess the money will come from me one way or the other. She refolded the chairs and changed the curtains and changed everything. When I came back and I opened the door, this is not my house. But to tell you the truth, from that day, I removed my hand from, I know, say, I enter another person's corner. What I was doing is not my job. It is the job of a woman. So I was presuming that I knew what was good. But my wife knows better. So from that day, 19 years ago, I'm 19 years old in marriage. From that day till now, cutting, I no go near where cutting though, because I will not choose the one that will be nice. I don't, all those things, I have left it. And I can tell you that they are more beautiful than whatever choice I would have made. So I learned my own lesson in the hard way. Some people don't learn. Rather than get annoyed, I saw something that is unique, that this woman has, you know, ability to decorate things. So you better leave her in that ministry and then concentrate on my own and leave her to it. The woman needs to beautify the home. The woman is also needs to create the atmosphere for a man to thrive. Wait, let me tell you. Most of the men that you see, when you see a man that is looking very angry, go back to his home. Something is wrong. When a man is boisterous, happy, cheerful, relating well with the rest of the people in the public, go and check it. There is something about his home that is peaceful. And it is the woman that creates the atmosphere where peace, tender care, self-control, patience, understanding, all of those things are put in place. Without that environment, we are talking about a man, the ultimate, you know, the man finding favor, obtaining favor, and reaching a goal. Forget about it, you cannot. It is the sacrifice of the women. Because I remember in the days when I was, I'm sure my brother Prof will relate to it. So you need to write a lot of paperwork, do a lot of paperwork. And many times it's not convenient to do it in the office. It's when you finish, you gather material, then when everybody is, you know, then you now sit down and start writing. For you to become a professor, you need to keep publishing. If the woman does not create that environment, because she has to double up to take over some of the things that you were supposed to have done in order to give you the space to climb. Amen. When you're climbing, drag your wife along. Don't climb and you're a professor and your wife is a secondary school holder. Tomorrow you will begin to say she doesn't know how to speak English. When you were writing, did you drag her along? So men also should, you know, be part of this process. But it's the woman that creates this environment that eventually makes the man to thrive. If the man does not succeed, there's something wrong from the home where that man is coming from. And when you have this reinforcement from your wife, from your partner, you have all the courage, all the energy to go out there and conquer the world. Even when they ask you to stop working, you will find more energy to keep working. Because you know, when you get back to the house, there is somebody that will look you in the face and say, "My husband, you've done well. You're working very hard. Come and sit down. Come and relax. Praise the Lord." Finally, I will just bring to us at the last lap of my discussion. When you obtain favor, what happens to you as a man? One, you will have enough time, I've said that, to concentrate on your meaningful activities. You will achieve more with the little time that you have. You're also able to save more money. There are people that came into this town and they were working in very highly reputable companies and all that, and they had a lot of money, but their wife never encouraged them to do anything. So at the end of the day, they will live like tenants. They can even go and rent a house in GRA, a duplex in GRA, instead of buying a land in Elopranwa. They will live in that, and then they blow away the money. Then when the man has retired, you say, hey, we don't have a house, so we don't have a house to live in. With a woman that has the favor from the woman, you can achieve more. You can have a legacy assured due to the upbringing of your children, because it's the woman that is actually at home all the time to tender to these children. So the legacy of your family depends a lot on how much they are able to gather from their mother. Divine health, including less stress, controlled blood pressure, longevity. There are some men that, you know, today hypertension is, I mean, one in every two or three men has high blood pressure. They're hypertensive. So there's a lot of pressure already in the home. But when there is peace in that home, at least when you're giving the medication, it will work. It will be controlled. There are a lot of us that have blood pressure, but it's controlled because the environment is conducive to help in sustaining it. There is societal pride and ability to measure up to your expectations. And you also get encouragement in times of difficulty, especially these days that things are hard. Now, let me tell you the shocking truth. There are more gainfully employed women today than there are men. A lot of men are unemployed, and I'm seeing a lot of men are not doing anything. It is their wives that are selling in the market. It's their wives that are working, doing all kinds of menial jobs, or doing one thing or the other to sustain the family. So that encouragement the man needs in times of difficulty can only come from a woman that, you know, is a harbinger of favor. Then there is motivation when success is around the corner. I just pray that as women, that God will make us to be favors, a source of favor for our children, for our husband, for our families. That as men also, as we continue to, you know, encourage our wives, that which God has designed, that ultimate purpose of God in marriage, shall be brought to pass in our lives. May that be my portion and your portion in the name of Jesus. Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Prof. We thank God for this evening. When I called my brothers for this lecture, I had struggle, almost the same struggle that I had with group leaders. On Wednesday, we have 12 groups, and I gave the 12 group leaders same topic to handle. But God, in His own wisdom, still made each group to be outstanding, had something to say different from the other. And that is what we have also experienced this evening. When I approached my brothers for this lecture, I almost had a struggle of defining the dimension they should go. But I just prayed and said, God, You directed. Give Your servants what to say. When they brought their work for printing, I just couldn't help but thank God. Our father and brother, Professor Kenneth Odo, did justice to kind of
the definition and meaning and all that, laying foundation for it. And I saw Professor Okeh's own dealing with the issue of our text. And God just said, this is the foundation, and use this person to. So you can see that our God designed this year's program for us to really, really end the modern Sunday becoming actual favors to our husbands, actual gifts. At this point, we may have one question or the other. If you have written anyone or you have a question, please bring the questions, the ones written down, either for Professor Kenneth or Professor Okeh. But Prof, I heard two of you made mention of marriage being a voluntary decision. You both said the same thing. Professor Kenneth said that it's a lifetime, voluntary lifetime decision. And then when Professor Okeh was also saying, he made mention of it also being a decision that one took voluntarily too. My question now is, how do you, and when Professor Okeh, you were making mention, I also heard, is it different types of union, connect and all that. High intensity, high connect, high this. For those that are like arranged, not out of voluntary, but they entered, and it's not like what they wished, but they just have to be Christians because they don't want that stigma of being divorced. What advice do you have for such people? Because currently, there are people that their marriages were arranged. And there are also parents, for sake of class, insist and want to arrange marriage for their children. I don't know how you can help us. Any of you can answer this while we look at the other questions. Please, can we have our special duty young wives,
praise the Lord,
provost and all that, help out with the microphone?
Well, when we look at God's plan for marriage, He did not create a room for divorce. When the Bible said He made them male and female, and they were supposed to be joined together and become one, He did not make provision for divorce. However, people find themselves in situations where it looks as if the relationship is not what they actually wanted. And I would like to address it from this point of view. The fact that when two people are relating, and there is, you know, there's what we call like, is a four kind of tests. The only reason why two people, are not finding the relationship compatible is that there are differences. Okay? Now, differences exist between even friends, even among siblings. We don't have people who are exactly the same. And I want to put it this way, that even God Himself, when God created and when God tried to describe the church is made up of different kinds of people, different kinds of vessels, different kinds of gifts. No two people are exactly the same. Now, the trick to surviving in those relationships is to leverage on the positives and downplaying the negatives. There is no marriage that is perfect. I've never seen a perfect, 100% perfect marriage. When you see a perfect marriage, somebody is enduring something. Now the decision is that there are things that I will have to bear for the sake of this union. And there are crosses that you will also have to bear for the sake of this union. And with that in place, let's begin to promote something that is positive about ourselves and downplay the things that are negative. The way you lay your bed is the way you will lie on it. And marriage typically is an investment. If you invest love, if you invest affection, if you invest prayer, if you invest sacrifice, even if the other person is a stone, it will take just a little while and God will turn that person around. So I don't believe in divorce, basically, no matter the reason for it. Because I believe that there is nothing that your wife or your husband can do to you that you cannot forgive him or her. Jesus forgives us everything, and we are supposed to live like Christ. So if God forgave us everything and died for us, there's nothing that anybody will do to you that you will not be able to forgive. So forgive in advance, leverage on your differences, and invest in the life of that person those things that you want for your own life. And God will make it happen. God has healed so many marriages in that situation. Praise the Lord.
Thank you. Why we trust God and then do all of what you've advised us to do? What further advice do you have for parents in terms of deciding the choice of a spouse for their children, considering your statement that there comes a time in every marriage that one's choice is questioned? So when you know the decision was made by you, you will be able to say, Satan, get behind me, this is my husband, I'm putting you. So what do you have to tell parents who, even in this current age, for sake of class?
Okay, I mean, you've qualified it. You said for sake of class.
Yes,
if it is purely for the sake of class, I will presume that somebody who is of the age of marriage should also be able to take a decision. I mean, the young man and the young lady, whether they like themselves enough to get married. But I would like to say also that in the Bible we also had examples of some kind of arranged marriages. When Isaac wanted to take a wife for Jacob, he asked his servant to, go and get a wife, for me. I think it's Abraham and Isaac. He said, go and get a wife for me from so place. And he gave him a task, and the servant swore that I'm not going to get anybody from any other tribe. He specifically did his master's bidding. And those marriages were classical examples of success. Now, there's an element of matchmaking that is compatible. For instance, marrying from the same household of God, marrying from reputable families. And even in those days, I don't know about now, when I wanted to get married and I met my wife in the church, I had to send people to go and find out where she comes from, unknown to her. That is still part of the search. So when you do, and what were we trying to do? You were trying to know the background of the family. And somebody, my in-law, told me, if you want to know how your wife behaves and how she will look, pay a visit to your mother-in-law. And I did pay a visit to my mother-in-law just to see how she behaved and how she is. And I've not seen much difference, even now, after 19 years, between what my mother-in-law does and how my wife does it. So what am I trying to explain? It's important that we parents also get involved in making the choice. I don't believe you can wake up one morning and say you want to go and marry somebody from Russia and your parents don't have any contact. Because what a child sees standing up, the parents will see when they are sitting down. But it's not because of your own selfish reason that maybe you want your son or your daughter to marry the son of a big man or this, you know, somebody in that class. If that is the reason, then it already has a wrong foundation. Let the reasons for your choice be based on the word of God and the happiness of the people for whom that choice is being made. Praise the Lord.
Thank you very much. Being involved, let your reason be based on the word of God and the happiness of the people, not your personal interest. Thank you, Prof. We also have a question here for two of you. Anybody can answer. Said, in a marriage where it looks like the little potential you have is gone because everything is condemned. There's nothing you will do that is appreciated. Like, for instance, you made mention of you came back and your wife changed you appreciated her concept or the grace in her. That is not to say that we should wake up one day without consent from our husbands and do something. But at least you saw something that from your word, he said, this is not my own area. But there are some cases, even when you take permission from the question here, you put up ideas, the woman's idea is nothing. The little potential she entered the marriage with is gone. The brain cannot think again because anytime you come up with idea, it is never good. How can this woman help herself again to build her self and get herself back to feet, to have confidence in herself, because it's like she's losing it all, can't have no creativity anymore?
Praise the Lord. You cannot want to progress, go up, and if you are reasonable enough and you don't want your wife to also grow. Marriage is not a competition. I'm not competing with my wife who is bigger or who is more qualified. It's not an issue. So if somebody says something, suggests something, maybe you want to do something, if I'm taking your own contest, then she suggests something. Don't also believe that whatever you are suggesting must also be taken. Praise the Lord, though. This is what we want to do. And then she suggests something. Don't take it that this one that I suggested must be taken. That's another thing. It has to be, of course, all of us know that the man takes the final decision. There's no two ways about it. But that you suggested something and it was not taken should also make you to say you lose all your sense or everything. I don't understand. But if you suggest today, when it is not taken and otherwise was taken, what was the outcome? Because we are talking about two people now achieving a purpose. So if that otherwise was taken, which is not yours, and the outcome was good, so you did not also make that your own a nullity. Because at the end of the day, there was an achievement. There was a success. So that you suggested 10 times, and 10 times was not taken, and the outcome was taken as otherwise, the decision was taken otherwise, and the outcome was good, should not make you feel inferior. Unless you are just being inferior to yourself. Praise the Lord, though. Unless it's you now, it's only you that will see yourself as inferior in this case, not the other person. But you also need to train yourself as a person. You must have a superior argument for you to be taken. You cannot just come and something is happening, you just say this other way and expect that somebody will just take it like that. It's not done. So that be as it may be, it's also men are not here, but also we are talking to women.
They are the back.
Okay, good.
They are the back. They
okay,
the
good. The thing is that instead of refuting the thing sharply, you can just say, okay, wait, let me explain. This is 1, 2, 3, 4 reasons why I think the thing should not be done like this. Sometimes if my wife suggests something and is not comfortable with me, I can keep quiet and allow the situation to play out. As in the process of time, the things will play out the way it will play out, without any quarrel, without any no. You understand? Okay, well, let's see how it goes. If I'm not too comfortable, if I know that at that point, if I reject it, it's going to cause some discouragement, I may just keep quiet and allow the situation to play out on its own. What I'm trying to say is that don't rule out yourself because your decision has not been taken. Don't be pessimistic because for some time, maybe your solution are not. I think that's the scenario I'm trying to see here. And then develop yourself to the point that you can have a superior argument. And again, if you marry somebody and it's like your friend, not when you marry somebody that is like your father. Praise the Lord, though. So when the class is there and this other one is here, it's very likely that anything you say that was not taken, you feel like it's because it's I'm here now. Praise the Lord, though. That is why this thing is not taken. But if you're on the same level, almost the same level, you understand? And the same level, I'm not talking about age or something, but at least you develop yourself to a point where people can talk. You will not feel like that. Because if you are with your friends and you suggest something that did not take, will you say you are nothing, you will not follow them again? So that friendship has to be developed so that we can reason together for a better outcome.
And then so that you can take the second part, say some potentials that one entered with in the marriage has been taken. Like he is a doctor, the wife is a doctor, and then when they got married, the man will say, you, doctor, sit down, let me go do doctor. You know, there are women like that they are still facing it. What advice do you have for such women? They entered with great potentials into the marriage, but a kind of dictatorship, this thing, taking away the potential.
Okay, they are in two dimensions. Let me just add a little to what he said. And that's the fact that men are very logical. And a lot of times, women may have very good reasons or decisions. But majority of times, those decisions are clouded by sentiments. Now, and emotions. Now, what needs to happen is that when you have an argument or you have a decision you want, you know, to be carried out, you have to make an effort, like he said, to convince the man. Have an argument. Provide a superior argument. Good reason why this has to be so. Every reasonable man will take that reason. That's number one. Then I will also come on the side of the men. And there's what I call the winning formula in a man-to-woman argument. What is that winning formula? If you are a man, allow your wife to win most of the times. And when I mean most of the times, there are 1,001 reasons, the things that happen in the house. And somebody says, oh, I want this fan to face here. The other person says, no, let the fan be at the other end. If I check it and the fan is going to be at the other end and it will still reach me, why do I need to struggle? Let the fan be there now. 1, 2, 3 times, 4 times, she's winning. Each time, because unconsciously, there's a reinforcement in her psychology that when I take decisions, my husband, you know, just honors those decisions. But for me, there are red lines that will not be crossed. What are those red lines? Any decision that is very likely to impact on our relationship or the further growth of the family. And I think it is not in the interest of the family. I put my feet down and it is fine now. It doesn't matter the argument. I'm not going to change it. But because she has been winning, we had 10 times and she won 10 times, 9 times. And I'm only winning this once. But this single one that I won has significant impact in the family. So this is a way to reinforce her own confidence, in the sense that when you're part of the winning team, why should you struggle that I only won once? And then, you know, it's not a competition, but unconsciously, people want to contribute to decision making in the home. Now let's look at the second angle.
Potential.
Somebody has potential, and it's really unfortunate. And I dare to say that men who suppress their wives' potentials are men who are inferior. They have inferiority complex. For crying out loud, I tell my wife, what is she going to achieve differently? If she achieves it, it's just going to add to what I already have. It's not going to threaten me. If she becomes a governor, it means I'm going to live in the government house. Will she stop me from driving the government car? What of the convoy? Would they not carry me when I'm going? Why should I struggle? If she has money to build a duplex and I'm living in a boy's quarter, for crying out loud, I will ginger her. May she build the duplex, may we go live. Will she pursue me from the bedroom? No, be the same AC she can enjoy and I can enjoy. Any man who suppresses the wife has an inferiority complex and he needs to deal with himself. That is the simple argument. Now, if you have found yourself in that position, you need to have a discussion. Because truly, women in that position, some of them have serious mental problems, psychological problems. You know, they become so, you know, so dejected that they are not able to do whatever they need to do. And it all comes from the time of making the choice, the conversations you had during courtship. I will not forget when I brought my wife for the first time to meet the uncle is mommy's husband. The first question he asked me is, you are marrying this girl, she just has a bachelor's degree. When you marry her, what next for her? I say, as soon as we get married, she will register for her master's. If she says she's not going to school, that is a problem. But for me, she will register for her master's. Because if she's doing master's and she wants to do PhD, go and do the PhD. You want to do business and I have money to support you, I give you. Look, let me tell you, when women have money and they are happy, you will enjoy in the home. Oh. I'm telling you, you will enjoy. Because when they go out, they buy things. This shirt I'm wearing, now madam buy them all. If she doesn't have, will she buy for me?
I wonder.
She will not buy for me. So empowering your wife and your spouse is the biggest thing that you can ever do for yourself. Because in the first instance, stress is reduced. When I say I don't have money and she has, will I be bothered? Because I know she's going to solve her own problems herself without bothering me. So it's more stress if you suppress the person. My advice to such women is to have a conversation with your spouses again and try to let them know how important. And I've also understood women who don't contribute to making money are more frivolous with spending. Women who don't do anything in the house do not know the value of making money. My wife does her own small business, as she does. And I see how she converts. Before she started doing that business, some things I was telling her, it wasn't making sense. Now she knows that she cannot use her money from her business to buy something unless it's a profit. But if she doesn't do that, she may not understand it. So men need to realize that if your wife is gainfully employed or doing something meaningful with her own life, you have less trouble. Gossip will not be there. There will be no fights in the yard. There will be no quarrels to settle. There will be no time to check your phone and scroll all the missed calls because she's busy answering her own call. Is it not true?
Yeah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Thank you very much. Still, lastly, for this evening, you say, what is responsible for husbands who once loved their wives and then after some years of marriage start hating them with all bitterness?
Let me give you the first shot. I know Prof has a lot to say. But first and foremost, we need to go back to the basics. What attracted you to that woman in the first instance? That's the first thing. Bible says charm is deceitful, beauty is vain, but the woman that fears the Lord, the woman that that fears the Lord, she shall be blessed, or something. So you see this skin. When I got married, I was one fine boy. This white hair, beard, no day, your mommy not true, Abby. And as I'm aging, my wife will also age with me. It's natural. So now the truth is that if all that you're looking for is how beautiful the wife is, okay, when that pregnancy comes, she has made babies and everything, the configuration changes. You need to do something to reactivate the first. What is that thing that attracted you? Now, one of the things that has helped us as a family, because the truth is, after a while, when there is a lot of pressure, children come, school fees, work, this in-law, the other one, you get so emboldened that you begin to pay less attention to yourselves. What has helped us is that from time to time, we try to reactivate that earlier charm that we had. We tell stories about, you remember the day I met you? You know what I said that day? You know what you did? Remember the first time we went out, this and that. And then sometimes you give surprises. There's one day I just woke up my wife. I said, let us go out. You are stressed out today. He said, what do I need to do? Where are we going now that she's tired? I said, don't worry, let us. We just drove. I went through GRA to make the journey longer, passed through like this, and landed in Lomeridian. I have booked a suit for us. I said, we are going to spend this weekend here together. Children, let them take care of themselves. Those children, we are there when we got married. They were not there. And I thought they were always going to be there. As I speak to you now, it's still just me and that my wife. Those children, they've all gone somewhere else. They're in school. We went there, spent the weekend together. I gave her a fantastic treat. By the time we left on Monday morning, back to the house, if you see how pretty my wife was looking, she changed overnight. No, I'm telling you the truth. So you must reactivate that love. And then for the woman, there are a lot of us that feel that I'm married. Is there anything else? Is there anything else to bother about? After all, my husband is venerable. So there's no need to look fine. Let me tie wrapper here and be moving. Please, if you are in that habit, change it. The man that you say is a professor and a reverend, the number of women that are flashing the thing in his presence every morning, there are plenty. So you need to take care of yourself. Dress well. If you see that hair, the other day you get one hair, my wife said, they do that type now, they do that type. I say, you want that type? I say, yes. Go and do it. So that when she does the hair, and you're seeing that hair from another place, you will know. You begin to reactivate yourself. Dress well. Prepare yourself well. You know, some people in the night, they tie wrapper here. Those things does not attract a man now. Abi, wear the lingerie. That's fine one. When we say, if the man, they want watch, Chelsea. Even if Man U and Chelsea are playing, he say, this match no sweet today. He go put them off. Follow you, come out. What is he going? That attraction and sexual intimacy is very important in a healthy relationship. And it's lacking in many of our homes. So, sexual intimacy, romance, those things that make a woman feel good. Every woman likes romance. And then, every woman also likes kind words, telling her what she wants to hear. There is one formula. Let me tell that formula before I drop the microphone. And that formula is this. Do you know that if you buy wristwatch, fine wristwatch, golden wristwatch for your wife, it's called 5%. You buy her a car, you know how much it takes to save to buy a car, be? You score 20%. You buy her clothes, beautiful clothes, you score 10%. But she wakes up in the morning, and as she's going, say, come. Hey, you look so beautiful today. I love you, my honey. Do you know your score? 70%. Your car, your wristwatch, your iPhone, your iPad, all of them put together was not equal to the I love you that you said in the morning. And I can tell you the truth. If the woman gets to hear it as often as possible, forget about this story you're telling her. The woman will stay. She will be happy. So these are the ways that this thing can be reactivated. I wish the men are here so that they can hear. Because it depends on them. Some of us are very stiff. Very stiff. Very stiff. I'm a man, so why should I say it? Why should I say it?
Chaplin and rector.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So let's reactivate the love in our homes. It has a formula. If you follow the formula, it will work. Sometimes just do surprise. So just very small thing. And the woman, is she a couple? Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Even you as a woman, work towards reactivating the love in the home. But we believe the rector and CMF chaplain, they will organize something for the men and bring our prof them to talk.
Okay, praise the Lord. I think he has even said more than what I wanted to say. But as he said, do you know that if the first time you start meeting with your wife, the attraction is more. There is a time two of you get naked in the room, nothing is happening now. No person is attracting to each other because you're already used to each other. It's not true. That's where we are. It now becomes like a normal person. Nothing again. It will happen. And it happens. But it now takes a conscious effort. Very conscious effort. Like some people are very busy. Well, let me say some of us are very, very busy. That I tried not to be carrying fight to the house, but it's not working. I still carry fights to the house. So as she get to the house, you sit on the reading table and start reading again. Okay, if you get to the house, you know, we'll be hold up in Port Harcourt. Maybe 5, 6. You might read up to 10. And you're already feeling sleepy. Immediately you lie down. It's now morning devotion. And then trying to prepare children for school. And the thing is resolving like that. But there is something you're not taking care of, which takes conscious, deliberate, well-calculated efforts to meet up. I was talking to some people about stress. I said, sexual weakness is a sign of stress. If you check those that have plenty, most of people that have 7, 8 children are on the low class because they are always together now. If rain is falling, good. But the other people, rain is falling, they're already on the road. So going to work is a form of contraception. Mainly those of us that are doctors, nurses, and others, because you sleep at, if you are at work, night duty, will you sleep with your wife? So it's already essential, it's a contraception going to work. So because then if you are at the hospital working, you cannot sleep with your wife now. If there's no way you will sleep with your wife from the hospital in the house. So it's not possible. So what I'm trying to say is the effects surrounding what you are doing will take away that intimacy between you and your husband. And women, being who they are, even if they are married for 30 years, will still allow the man to approach them, not them approaching the man. So now, you still, as a man, have a way of speaking to your wife for sexual intimacy to occur. It's not true. Rather than the other way around. But should it continue like that? Should you wait until that action comes from this other side? But the way we are trained as women from good homes and good churches, that should be what should happen, so that they don't call you a shawo. Even your husband timing you to be a shawo. And then if your husband call you a shawo, you start feeling bad that the man is calling you a shawo because he wanted sexual intimacy. Who should else you call you a shawo now? Praise the Lord. So what I'm trying to say is there has to be a very conscious effort. If not, you will see nagging, and then it's natural that things over time start dying down until it is reactivated. Even those of us in academics, don't read for 2 weeks now. You see, even as a doctor, you don't read, you don't go to do training and other things. You go to clinic, you don't know what to diagnose again. So you must keep on knowing what training to keep yourself abreast to that duty. It's not true. That is the same way. You need continuous training. If not, by the time it takes a longer time, you will hate the other side of the show will start happening. And that's what happens. So it's a process of time. And then every human being has that adventuring spirit. And that's where the Spirit of God comes to play in our lives. That's why I was saying you must set a goal, you must set a boundary, you must do this, you must do this. Reflect back that you have the Holy Spirit in you. And with the Holy Spirit will help you not to overstep that boundary, because that adventuring spirit is to know what it is in the other person, which now you are not permitted as a Christian. Praise the Lord. So you see that for those of them that are not Christians, so you know that it is more easier to commit adultery than to commit fornication. Yes, it is. It's easier to commit adultery that document fornication. It is so. And until we come to this consciousness that this is the truth of the matter, we will always miss it. So, since all of us are not saints, and we must reactivate whatever that has started. He said they will be saying, you know, when I met you, what was, you know, that is a way of realigning yourself again back to where you started. And you see the fire will come up again. No matter how busy we are, we should make a conscious effort. That is the summary of what I've just said. Making a conscious effort. It must not come from this side alone. It can come from the women's side. Don't feel that you are not going to be like, Nami go come beg man. You know, go come beg man, but you be wife. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord, oh.
Praise the Lord. Make conscious effort to reactivate the love. I'm getting message here, even if we want to round up, that you should please throw little light on financial prudence. There are people holding the ATM card can work for. There are others, like me, works more when the card is with Oga. It can flow very well. If I'm with it, I might not even be able to get what I want because I want to be over careful. He has been begging me, know my pin. So what works for this family might not work for the other family, so that it can be balance. And then the women also, you find out in some homes the man is not, maybe the woman is more financially viable or so, and most times you can face challenge of my wife will give me today, tomorrow I give you back, and it's never paid. So how do you balance both on the part of the woman and the man? In some families, some women borrow from their husbands and they will never pay back. Some wives borrow, some husbands borrow, they don't pay back. Where is the place of borrowing in marriage? And then the ATM thing. Because let some women not go here and say, give me your card.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I think the emphasis is actually on openness,
okay,
and prudence. Openness in the sense that if your wife knows what your capability and she has understudied you and knows that you're not in the habit of misusing whatever resources that are available to the family, I believe she will be reasonable in making her demands. It doesn't work for everybody like what we say, give me your card, give me this and that. But what will work is a level of openness. The truth is this: if my wife estimates that I earn 200,000 naira, whereas my real income is about 150, but she thinks that I may be earning up to 200, she will be having expectations of 200,000, and I can only fulfill that of 150. But if she's aware that I earn 200,000, and I have told her that out of this 200,000, we only have 100,000 to spend, though. The other 100,000 is for the children. This one is for tithe. The other one is for projects. The other one is for savings. The other one is to give to charity and support, and all of that put together. Everybody knows where it comes from and how it works. Now, another thing that also works in my own home is that even though I know my wife makes an income, I make effort to give her her own personal allowance. That money...
Just clap.
Yes. That money is not accounted for. I'm not going to ask her what she's going to do with that money. That is your personal allowance. Whatever you want to do with it, do with it. That's your money. But she knows that having also done that, She owes it as a duty and a responsibility to take care of certain things and exigencies. There are things I would take for granted. If as I'm here now, suddenly the light has gone off, and it is because there is no fuel to put fuel in the generator, I may not be rushing home because of that. Because I know she should have enough money in her pocket to bring out. Some of us are very stingy. What gets into, you know, like children, a child, your child asks you for, "Daddy, I want biscuit." You take her, buy the biscuit and give her. Then you say, "Can I have one piece of the biscuit?" You say, "No, Daddy." Eh? The one you brought your money. So the truth is that it's a two-way thing. I give you and you give me. Now, the normal thing, actually, is that the man should be the provider in the home. That is a natural process. But sometimes it doesn't work that way anymore. The man may be handicapped, this may not be well. And then the woman is now the one providing. Now, what I expect is that if I was given, I'm using the word, if I was given when I had, if I don't have, I don't think my wife would feel bad also giving to me now that I do not have. But the psychology of women generally, okay, that part of the control in the house is that you are able to provide. So when you are not the one providing the money, you have to manage the level of control that you want to exert. I've heard men who want to say, "You earn the salary and I will decide, I'm the head of the house. I will decide how that money is going to be spent." Please, that one does not work well. It does not work well. If the woman is the one making the money, let her decide how the money will be spent. But I believe also in a home that is closely knit together, the wife covers the shame of the husband. If the man cannot bring, the wife brings it. And it looks as if he was the man that can do it. I've even seen situations where they want to say, the woman will bring out and go and give them. So the man goes to give as if he's the one that brought the money, whereas it's the woman that actually brought the money and gave him to give. So it's a two-way thing, financial openness and accountability. You are not the one bringing. The woman brings it, and you now use it for something useless. The woman will not be happy anymore. Or the woman is the one bringing, and you are still in the house. After she has run around and come back, you expect her to also cook. You expect her to do the dishes. You expect her to make the bed. You expect her to pick up the children. If she's the one doing that, then she will be the one taking decisions in the home. That is the psychology. So if she's the one doing that, there is something else you will need to help out in doing that is equally meaningful. Maybe by the time she comes back, you have made a meal, and the meal is for everybody to eat. Why would she not be happy bringing out the money, knowing that she has worked hard and that you're saving her from those little things? Accountability, you know, openness, and ability to support one another in terms of need. That is just the magic. Praise the Lord.
Thank you very much, sir. The last part of it, and that will be last for this evening, is that both husband and wife are comfortable, and then the man wants to do an investment and said, "My wife, give me this amount. I will give you back." And that money was given. It was never paid. There is an investment to carry on, not that normal routine. And you say, "My wife, make up." That's the second part of the equation. And then you're also comfortable, I'm comfortable. But even if I'm working as a working class woman, our money is never enough for us. So I asked husband, and he was like, "What do you do with your money?" So these two, that's for people working now. collecting and not giving back, what do you do with your money? Even if I have taken from my husband and you hear such statement. Thank you, sir.
Okay, let me also come from the angle of accountability. Now, it doesn't really matter how much people earn. There are people who, no matter how much they collect from you, they will never give you back. And I think it is wrong. It's wickedness to borrow and not pay back. There are two things. The first is that every money that comes in the home belongs to the family. So my money in actual sense is not actually my money. I'm only a channel for which God is using to bring the money to the family. So the same thing from your wife. Now, having said that, if we decide that we are going to do a project, okay, there are two things in it. If I ask you to help me, support me to do this project, you will not expect me to pay back. Because the project that I'm doing is definitely not going to be a selfish project. It's going to be something that will benefit the family. But if I call it borrow, lend me, these are two different things. If you ask me to lend me, if I ask you to lend me, then you have the obligation to pay back what you have borrowed. That's the way I look at it. But if you want support, whatever the person brings to support is fine. But let us understand first and foremost, your wife is your next of kin. I presume that that is the truth for most families who are here. Your husband is your next of kin. Every money that is made in that home, even if I'm the one that is holding it, also belongs to my wife and the family. So whether she borrows it or I borrow it, what I would not want to recommend is borrowing or taking money and misappropriating it. That somebody school fees to pay for the children, she uses it for something else, I will be mad for in that kind of a thing. But generally, every money belongs to both of us. So long as it's used for the benefit of the family, that's the way it is. And that is for our good. Praise the Lord.
Maybe just add that. I don't understand that you begin to insist that your husband did not pay you back the money you borrowed. Alpha. The one you borrowed, man. No, it's in fact, if at any time my wife says, borrow me, I'll just laugh. I know the money is not coming back. It will not come back. I will not even remember that. I will not even want to say, give me back that money. No, it's an idea I'm having in my head now. So, if like another person, I'll go and borrow money. I do a project. I did not pay the money. So, the same thing with my husband and wife will be dragging. You've not paid me the money. Ah, I don't understand that one. There is a problem somewhere already in that marriage. There's a problem, and you even mentioned that two of them are comfortable. If you are comfortable, so why will borrow money they borrow? Why will it cause trouble now? If you are comfortable, two of them are comfortable. That was the background information. Two of us are comfortable. Okay, and the man wants to do a project. Project for who? Project for who? For two of us. They say, borrow me money. The man just collected money to add to what he has to do the project. He's not going to pay you. Forget it. You should not cause quarrel. Because unless, as he said, that money was misappropriated, it was now wasted. That is where you should be having issues. But that I use money, maybe I want to do real estate or build a house where I will go and give rent. Then you say, you must pay me back. Stay on the road. If not, if it's me, I will just... In fact, I don't understand. There is no borrowing. I've not seen any borrow that even paid. Do they used to pay you people? How many have they paid? The one you borrowed, did you pay? Hey, you did not pay too. So leave this thing. So naked they come, borrow me. Know that thing. They say, well, I'm just collecting the money and doing what it is. In as much as that is done for hours. I've seen some people that next of kin is their brother in their house, not their husband though. That is the people that will be borrowing this thing now and be wanting to be paid back. Some people, next of kin is their first son or first daughter. or sister, not their husband though. It's plenty, plenty. Even in the hospital card, as they come, you know, we have kind of kin. You just see somebody's name son, somebody's name brother. But you come with the husband though. So it just tells you that there is trouble already in that home. So that kind of borrow will cause trouble. But when everything is surrounding about two of us, you say borrow. Okay, my wife said, give me 1,000 naira there. Of course, I know she has that 1,000, but I'll just laugh. You just won't collect this one now. I won't go now. I'm going to take. Because it will not come back. Of course, the borrowing, whether it is in millions or whatever. Now, if my wife does anything, I take it like that is what I'm supposed to have done. So for her to do it is something that has relieved me. So I should even be thankful. Okay, if maybe her mother is sick and she goes there to pay the hospital bill, you know me that's supposed to pay my mother-in-law's hospital bill, and my wife pays for it. Has she not saved me from that trouble? I don't understand again. No person is talking. So, so it's just as like it's just as simple as that. So if I also do something, like if somebody comes to the house and the husband gives the person money, when the person say, "Ma, thank you," I don't know whether it doesn't happen like that in your place. Your husband gives somebody money. The person sees you on the road and say, "Ma, thank you, the money I received." You may have not even known. It's okay. You just claim as if he knew. Oh, your wife did this thing, you know. He gave me money. Thank you very much. Oh, God will bless you people. I say amen. So it's supposed to, that oneness must be there. They will not pay that money. You know. They use it for your house.
Praise the Lord. Why we call on the leader of all leaders for vote of thanks, Lady Chinyere Oku. I want to encourage you to freely walk into Ozaro Memorial Specialist Hospital at 88 NTA Apra Link Road, Mboba, if you need a good medical care. And feel free also to walk to Image Diagnostic Center. When you get to any of those places, just tell them, "You came to my church, so I can walk in freely." Over to you, ma, for vote of thanks.
Mama, mama. Nene, nene, nemo, nemo, nema, mama, ne, John, John, oh, bukwan, nemo, ne, oh, nemo, ne, oh, nemo, ne, oh, dem, pum, po, oh, dog, oh, logo, oh, bukwan, nemo, nemo. Oh, Nemo. Women, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Our daddies, Professor Kenneth Odu, and our Professor Okechukwu. On behalf of our mama, our Bonge mama, Dr. Mrs. Chimila Samuel, we say a very big thank you to you. You have done so wonderful to us this night, and we promise that all you have said to us, we will really, really achieve it. From this day, I myself have learned a lot of things, and I will follow suit. I will make sure the family is in order. I will make sure the family is standard to God's purpose. I will make sure that I will not be an initiator of problem. Even if I see the problem coming forth, I will know how to tackle it. Thank you for taking us on these topics. We have really, really learned a lot. As you go, we pray that God will bless you and increase you in every aspect of your life, in Jesus' name. I call on Daddy.
Praise the Lord. Let us pray for our brothers. I would like for you to stretch forth your hands and say a word of prayer. Say, ask the Lord to bless them. They've been a source of blessing to the ministry of the word, and their responses to the questions. that their own marriages will fulfill God's ultimate purpose also. In Jesus' name we pray. Father, thank you for your servants that you have used to minister unto us in this program tonight. Thank you, O Lord, for the gifts you have given them and for the gifts that they are. Lord, they have blessed us in the course of this meeting tonight. They have spoken to us. The words have started transforming our lives. And Lord, there are more things that will still happen. Lord, because they have blessed us, we know one thing, that virtue has gone out of them. We are asking that, Lord, you will replenish them abundantly in the name of Jesus Christ. We pray that their homes will be blessed indeed. Their children will surround their table. Their children will not be misfired arrows. Their children will not bring them pain and sorrow. Lord King of Glory, their children will be for signs and wonders in Israel. Thank you, Lord. Blessed be your name. As they go, we pray that your presence will go with them, that they will continue to prosper in the places where you have placed them. Thank you, Father. Blessed be your name, O God. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank you so very much, sirs. Now, just before we pray, as they lead them, I'm assuring you in 2 minutes or three, we'll be done. You know, today is the Annunciation of the Blessed Virgin Mary. I just want to read a verse or scriptures. We are supposed to have service, but because of all these activities, we had to create space. But let's just say something about this Annunciation. If you look at Luke chapter 1, verse 38, put it on screen. In 5 minutes, we'll be done. Luke 1:38. When the angel of God appeared to announce to Mary, when he had the Annunciation of the Blessed Virgin Mary, it was when the angel came to announce, that's where he had Annunciation, announced to her that she was going to carry to be the mother of God. It had never happened in the history of the world. It had never happened. No woman had conceived before without having carnal knowledge of a man, or a man having carnal knowledge of her. When this woman heard that thing from God through this angel, she said in verse 38, and that's what I want you to go home with. Put it on the screen as we close. Then Mary said, "Behold, the maidservant of the Lord, let it be to me according to your word." That's how she concluded that message. And the angel of the Lord departed. Angel didn't have any other business again. Like, what I came for is done. The moment God announced his program to this young virgin girl who was preparing for her marriage, she didn't struggle with God. She said, "I am your servant. Whatever you want to do with my life, do with it." If God announces something to you now, would that be your response? Or has that been your response? Or is that your current response to God? Is that something God has said to you? Are you saying to him, "Let it be the way you said it"? The moment the angel heard this thing, it was like, my assignment is done. Let me go and tell God I've finished. That's why we celebrate her. Because she didn't play with the word of God. Even if what God told her has never been told any woman in the history of the world. She didn't say, "Now I want marry. Now they can't tell me this. I know fit, I beg. Go look for another person. Here am I, send my sister." She said, "I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be the way the Lord wants it. Can heaven trust you enough to commit something into your hands? Because they know, because heaven knows that you will say, let it be the way God wants it. Or would you struggle with God? Are you struggling with God? Have you struggled with God? Are you still struggling with Him? In the midst of all these things, can we learn something from Mary? Every 25th of March, we celebrate her, this Annunciation, this time when God said something, and she didn't struggle. She said, let it be like that. It's okay. Even if it will obstruct my marriage, my traditional marriage, even if it will turn my life around, as long as it has to do with God's program, let it be the way God says it. Can we end this meeting with that resolve? Say, God, in this season, in my marriage, in my ministry, in my work with you, let it be the way you said it. Let's bow our heads to pray. Can you talk to God? We've heard things about marriage. Can you say to God now, let it be the way you said it? There are things that God said in this meeting about marriage. You don't need your husband to be here. He's not here, so why do you break your head? Is there something God has said to you about you? Sometimes when we hear the word of God, we say, Pastor, you need to preach this sermon again on Sunday, because the people that have this sermon, they are not here. So you were a waste product or a waste pipe in that service. Can I say this to you? The people that need everything that was said here today are here. It's because God loves you, that's why He released these words. Can you say to Him, let it be to me according to your word? In my life, in my marriage, in my ministry, in my job, in the things I do, let it be to me according to your word. Can you be bold? That statement obstructed her life. That statement changed her personal program. She had things she had in mind to do. That statement almost made Jacob to throw her away. He contemplated it. She knew the implication of that statement, but she made it. Let it be to me according to your word. That was her response to the Annunciation. What is your response to what God is announcing in this meeting? What God has been announcing since Monday about God's ultimate purpose for marriage? What is your response to it? Mary's own was, be it unto me according to your word. Father in heaven, we thank you for your word we have heard tonight. We thank you, O King of Glory, for the diverse things you have said to us. Lord, many times you tell us very hard things. Just as you told Mary a hard thing. That was a virgin girl who had never known a man. And you are giving her an assignment that nobody in the history of the world had ever done. That was the first time a virgin was going to bear without sleeping with a man. But she did not quarrel with you. Give us that kind of pliable spirit so that in your hands we can move any direction. Lord, we pray that as we celebrate Mary and we celebrate that Annunciation, when God had to come down to announce about the divine plan for the salvation of sinful humanity, Lord, Mary cooperated. Help us to cooperate with you in your divine plan for us, for our family, for our church, for the community. Help us to say, let it be to me the way you want it. As hard as it may be for us. Lord, there are things you have said to us. We pray that, Lord, that will be our response. Whatever has made it difficult, is it us? Is it men? Is it women? Is it youth? Is it husband? Is it wife? we pray you will address that thing, Lord. And we ask, O God, that we will rise from this meeting tonight, saying, from henceforth, let it be to me according to your word. Thank you, Heavenly Father, as you continue to carry us. And Lord, we pray that your ultimate purpose for our marriages will be fulfilled. Be glorified and exalted. Bless the offerings that we are going to give now, and cause us not only to be blessed, but to be blessings. In Jesus' name we pray. Let's take choruses as we do our offerings.
Praise the Lord. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. 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 You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Tambira Jehovah, Tambira Jehovah, Tambira Jehovah. Oh, Tamira Jehovah, Tamira Jehovah, Tamira Jehovah, Tamira Jehovah, Tamira Jehovah, Tamira Jehovah, Yelele, 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 Tamira Jehovah.
Please, because of time, it's almost it's 7:45. The group leaders have been asked to write the names of their group members that are here and submit, instead of us asking groups 12 times, group 1, group 2. So please write the names and submit. Once again, thank the men for being part of the program tonight. The Lord will bless you, the men and all the others, youth, who are here to be part of this program of our women. The Lord will bless you in Jesus' name. What's the program tomorrow? Cathedral. So it's not everybody. Select. All right. So the persons, what's the time? 8:30. So please take note of that. The Lord will bless you. The service on Sunday is at 8 a.m. It's combined. Let's rise up to pray. All right. Members of council, don't forget we have our council meeting tomorrow at 7 a.m. Members of council, let's rise. In the name of Jesus, our Father in heaven, we are grateful to you. We thank you for bringing us to your presence where there is fullness of joy, and your right hand where there are eternal pleasures. Thank you for blessing us through the ministry of your word, through the ministry of prayer. Lord, thank you, God, for your servants that you use to minister to us. Thank you for the things we learned. It's now time for us to go. We pray that your presence will go with us. We cover the road with the blood of Jesus. Father, those who like to reap where they did not sow, wherever they are they on the road as kidnappers, as armed robbers, as Yahoo boys, as ritual killers? I pray, O King of Glory, tonight that your angels will pursue them, will scatter their gang ups. They will not see anyone moving from this place or that has moved already. We cover everyone with the blood of Jesus Christ. And Lord, we pray, O God, that you tomorrow's program at the diocese will be a success. And we'll gather here on Sunday celebrating our wives and our mothers. And it will also be a success. Thank you, Father. Bless us and cause us to remain blessings. In Jesus' name we pray. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. The Lord be with you.
Shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't.